Thank you and welcome to this webinar. Let me share my screen. I hope it's correct one. So this webinar is about OpenAI's progress regarding a scholarly commons. And actually, I have a question already in the beginning to you. Maybe you can answer them in the chat. If I would like to know how familiar you are with OpenAI, because this would help us a little bit in what detail we need to explain some OpenAI aspects. Okay. So we want to talk today about OpenAI's perspective on scholarly commons briefly. And we want to touch three aspects, which are the OpenAI guidelines, supporting platform interoperability, the recommendations for publishing platform enhancements, the sustainable, cooperative, and non-APC publishing models, and the cost transparency and open access publishing. So actually not three, but four aspects. So thank you, Gwen, who started a survey. How well do you know OpenAI? If you could provide your input. Maybe Gwen, could you provide the results?
Do you see this now? Oh, hold on.
Okay, so most of you know at least a little bit about OpenAI, about 80% and roughly 20% are quite well familiar with OpenAI. So that's good. So we don't need to start from scratch and tell you the whole story. So DAO is a scholarly commons. The starting point here is actually the definition by Force 11, who introduced this activity within a working group in 2016. And they held two workshops, and they come up with the concept of a scholarly commons as an agreement among researchers and other stakeholders in scholarly communication to make research open and participatory for anyone, anywhere. And it also means that a scholarly commons is comprised of a set of principles, concrete guidance to practices and actions towards inclusivity of diverse perspectives. And also very important is that a scholarly commons is owned by no one, but to be realized, used, and contributed to by all. So when OpenAI started, the OpenAI Advanced project started in 2018, we had a dedicated work package towards scholarly commons. And in this work package, we focus on three aspects: the interoperability, including the OpenAI guidelines, technologies of next generation repositories, sustainability, platform enhancements, and transparency with regard to the costs of open access publishing. Today, we will not talk about next generation repositories. This could be done at a later point in time. So we will focus on the first and the third aspect. And now the floor, I give the floor to Andreas, who will introduce you about the OpenAI guidelines and tell you what it has to do with the scholarly commons.
Yes, good morning, good evening, and good afternoon, everyone and everywhere you are. The Open Air Guidelines, in a nutshell, I call it, has a perspective of the researchers in the middle and the researchers' output and the research environment. So the most researchers publish literature like articles in different ways and have different kinds of possibilities to publish. The publishing repositories could be thematic, institutional, or journals, or e-journals like this. In the research output, most researchers has research data that could also be published in different repositories. Here are data repositories, catch-all repositories that are coming up in the last years, like Zenodo, and also institutional and thematic repositories that are based on the local institution where the researcher is. And some of the researchers writing and programming research software. And for this, there was different repositories, software repositories, or it could be also used the catch-all repository. And the researchers have any other research output that could be published in a catch-all repository. This is the publishing products that the researchers are have. And the researchers also in a special environment, in a research environment. So in the last years, they're coming up some research information systems. And for this, in these research information systems that are, have projects and funders and organizations and so on in it. For these kinds of different aspects of the research output and the environment, Open Air introduced for 10 years the first guidelines, and we focus on the first guidelines in the landscape of the repositories. So please, next slide. The landscapes of the repository types that are described a little before are institutional publication repositories and all the other repositories that are, could have the research output in there. So on this side, we have the full landscape of the repositories. And with this, we take a look on the aspects of the research output. Please, next slide. There are the articles, what I say before, with preprints and reports, data sets, and so on. And if we look, we take a closer look into these repository types and literature resource types, we see, please click next, we see that in the institutional and thematic repository, there could be have literature you could have data sets and also in the meantime software and other research products in there. The same could we have for in the CRIS repositories, so CRIS for current research information systems. That could have also all types of the resource types before, and also additionally to that, the projects, funder information, organization information, personal information, and so on. The other types of repositories that have specific resource types in there, and we see here an overview about these types of repository. In this repository, it's very important to have a good metadata quality. This metadata quality should be up to date. Should be reflect the current state of the research output and recently the changes of these research output. To have a very accurate and valuable information in there that could the repository publish the information about the person identifier, the persistent identifier, or other identifiers that are related to this metadata. And to have no test records in a productive repository system. And these are some quality metadata quality aspects that we have in mind for the next slides. And with the next slides, the OpenAI guidelines objectives focus on the metadata quality aspects and also to harmonize these metadata. Please click next. And also with the implementation of the OpenAI guidelines, the repository have mainly the support for the FAIR principles, like the findable via identifiers, persistent identifiers, accessible via the OEPMH interface, reusable is mostly seen in the licenses that are provided by the repositories and so on. And it's describe any other different kinds of research products that we could have. By the way, with the OpenAI guideline or in the OpenAI guidelines, we are reusing existing standards like the Dublin Core format for the metadata exchange or the data site format. But also we have some extension in the guidelines for vocabularies. Last but not least, to facilitate these points above, we add some services on the top of these metadata that we are showing a little bit later in this webinar. As I said before, the open air guidelines have history over the last 10 years. Next slide, please. And started with the literature guidelines, mostly focused on articles and on journal articles and preprints. So the after 2 years, the next version of the guidelines was published and also introduced the guidelines for data archives, repositories. And Saron, we see the last 10 years in this in these evolution. And the latest, the major changes are in 2018 with the literature guidelines version 4. It's now called institutional and thematic guidelines. That was a step forward that we see in the repository landscape, that we have not only literature repositories out there, it's there's also an evolution on this landscape side. So it's what I showed before, the resource types in the repositories are involved also. So in 2020, we are updating our CRIS guidelines at the moment, and also we are updating the data archive guidelines to the latest data site format, and take a look on the other guidelines for software and research, other research products. With these guidelines in the over the last 10 years, we are that are fundamental for the data sources that OpenAI collected. And at the moment, we collecting over 12,000 data sources worldwide. You see here an overview, and the data sources are like Software Heritage or GitHub. We including Microsoft Academic Graph. We collecting from DataCit, from PubMed, Zenodo, and anything and any more from 12,000 data sources, and on the fundamental of our guidelines based on from the 10 years ago. And with this was a community driven, the guidelines was community driven in the last 10 years, and we would like to invite you to comment on the new guidelines and the implementation that experience that you have. And you see here the links for the feedback documents that we have introduced to these kinds. We put these also in the chat at the in the moment. And last but not least, for the guidelines here, we also working on a Google Sheet to have to reflect the repository platform evolutions and the guideline evolutions over the years. So to introduce to invite you also to take a look and give feedback on this document if we have something forgot in the repository platforms or versions. And you know that these repository platforms supports our guideline version and so on. If you have any feedback on the guidelines and you would like to give us these in the documents, you could also write an email to us to guidelines@openairu, or you find any feedback possibilities on the guidelines.eu, openair.eu. And with this, I would like to hand over to Jochen. And
maybe we can already try to answer one question in the chat. But please, actually, you should use the question and answer window for questions. So Frank Minister asks, do you collect any data from either base or core? I thought I saw base on a previous webinar, but I don't think either was on that previous slide. Yes, we collect metadata from Core UK, and you are right that this slide needs to be updated and to include also Core UK. We started collecting from Base, a small subset from Base a few years ago, and there is now an effort to collect from Base the set of repositories, especially those that are not yet present in OpenAIR. This is work in progress, and it's a similar challenge like to collect from other large or big data sources. Okay. So moving forward, the next topic, but somehow also related to the OpenAIR interoperability guidelines, is about publishing platform enhancements. This was one of the subtasks in this work package. And the motivation here is that interoperability, of course, is key across publishing platforms, repositories, and aggregators, so that they can exchange the metadata and digital objects in the proper way. But in particular, we wanted to know what are the current standards of institutional publishing platforms and scientific journals. So we wanted to investigate especially the journals more than repositories or book platforms or quiz systems. And then we want to find out what is the minimal set of common functionalities for publishing platforms for an integrated scholarly communication framework. And this work was done now almost 2 years ago. We conducted a study in November 2018, and in the study, we were asking questions regarding the about the platform and journal information in general, but also which metadata standards are supported, what kind of interfaces, APIs, other interoperability aspects are considered, and how well is the data source, the publishing platform already integrated with OpenAIR services, and how well are OpenAIR services received. From the participants, we received 21 answers from institutional platforms, which cover almost 1,500 journals. And from 17 participants, which operate standalone journals. And the main findings are regarding the platform and journal operating aspects that they are mainly run and supported at their own institutions in terms of staff and infrastructure support. But some of them also make use of alternative funding sources by help of communities, and a smaller fraction also is using APCs. Another interesting aspect was that most of these journals are affiliated to their own institution, which shows that there is a good collaboration at their institution, for instance, between the researchers and the library. And so they have their the infrastructure at home, so to say. There is an awareness of adoption of acknowledged quality standards. The platform and journals are usually registered in international indexes, registries, or directories, like QAJ, for instance. And a couple of these platforms also offer additional services like DOI minting or user statistics or editorial services, of course, or the support of citation styles and the export for different bibliographic databases. On the level of interoperability and metadata standards, the findings are that most of the platforms used OJS, followed by some using DSpace, but also Drupal, WordPress, and a small number developed their own custom solutions. More and more standards and identifiers are used, like ORCID and DOI, of course, by help of plugins, but also the encoding of the articles using the JATS XML format. The metadata description on the article level varies on different degrees of detail. This is also what we see in our daily aggregation activities in OpenAIR. And of course, this is an aspect which depends which metadata format is used. Is it Dublin Core or is it a more granular format like JATS, for instance? Most of the platforms and journals are using OAI PMH to expose their metadata. But there are also some limitations and opportunities for improvement, like to expose content licensing and project and funding information in a machine readable format. And then the third section was about the integration with and evaluation of open air services. The result of this survey was that only a limited number of platforms and journals is already registered for content provision in open air, but this can have different reasons. The one reason is that we are now almost 2 years later, and also many of the journal articles are collected via citation databases now, like Crossref or via DOAJ. So it could be that platform or journal owners and editors are not really aware that their platform or journal is integrated already in OpenAIR. So this could indicate that OpenAIR should provide more transparency, should make it easier to let content providers identify if their data source is in OpenAIR already registered or not. Also, the participants have rather low level of awareness regarding concrete OpenAIR services. And of course, most of interest to them are the aggregation environment, is a validation service, which is now visible to some extent to the content providers by help of the provide dashboard. Content discovery and visibility is now provided or made available via the Explore, OpenAIR Explore portal. Usage and access statistics is provided via the provide dashboard, but also via the SushiLite API, and there is also now a dedicated web page, usagecounts.openair.eu. But also of interest is a possibility to link funding and project information with publications and the feature of deduplication. The recommendations and main results of the survey are that on the level of metadata quality standards and semantic interoperability, the recommendation here is to make use of knowledge representation languages. Of course, this can be on a very basic level. Dublin Core could also be the data site format, MOTS or JATS. And if possible, also to make use of linked data representations. We also recommend, whenever possible, to make use of PIDs for different kinds of entities. So not only for the publication, but also for the project, for the funder, for organizations, for authors. And to provide references from the publication to other entities, like from the paper to the data set, or the paper to the project. And to make use of machine readable information for copyright and license information. On the level of interoperability, the recommendation is to support common and established APIs like OAI PMH, but also open search, the search and retrieval by URL, SRU, and a rather lightweight format like signposting. And of course, when we are talking about scholarly commons and open science principles, it also means to make use of open file formats with regard to long-term preservation. Of course, it should, if possible, PDF-A, but also EPUB format, XML, like describing the article in JATS XML, or formats for OpenOffice formats. Regarding long-term preservation, the recommendation is to make sure that the publishing platforms provide long-term commitment to make sure that the resources are also available and resolved in the future, to make content preservation and to follow archiving policies. And very important is also to create at least one copy of digital objects and metadata at a remote place, and to care about automated backup processes. The results and recommendations have been published in a deliverable, which published 1 year ago in 2019, and is available on Zenodo. Now coming to the third aspect, what OpenAIR and our work package considers on a scholarly commons, it's about sustainable cooperative non-APC publishing models. And the leading question here was how to sustain not-for-profit and non-APC-based cooperative publishing models with the goal of a universal, unrestricted, and immediate open access. The task team followed the following approaches. At first, we wanted to learn more about the current publishing landscape and existing non-APC initiatives. And we wanted to identify best practice examples. And to this aim, we had a call and invited a couple of stakeholders to make a SWOT analysis. And this was done in early 2019. And the results have been discussed at a workshop at Bielefeld University in February 2019. During the workshop on sustainable non-APC publishing models. The result of the workshop was to come up with a set of recommendations to funders, policymakers, and the publishing community, which I will explain in the next slides. But there was also some follow-up activities, like in May this year, where we had a joint webinar with the Latin American initiative, AMELICA, and with colleagues from Canada, from the Canadian Research Knowledge Network, and from their initiative Coalition Publica. And we also had a virtual meeting with the Global OA 2020 initiative. And we hope that we continue this kind of liaising with other initiatives, because only together we can achieve the vision of a global cooperative and non-APC publishing model. I said in the beginning that one of the big issues of scholarly commons includes inclusivity, to consider different ways and different perspectives. And this can also be seen in two approaches. One that has its roots by funders in Europe, the Plan S from Coalition S. But also another initiative, especially in Latin America, with AMELICA. While Plan S is more on regulating commercial agreements when APCs are involved, the aim of AMELICA was and is on building infrastructure from and for academic institutions which are owned by the scholarly community. And the aim is to take back control of the scientific publication system by academic institutions. So what do we understand under sustainability? First of all, we consider that there are different dimensions which influence the success of open access. This is the timely publication process, which must be fast, reliable, and stable, and quality ensured. but also concerns reliable services. And last but not least, business sustainable business models and a model of either funding or revenues so that such publication initiatives can operate. On the level of the service providers, this means there must be sufficient revenues to cover the operating costs of the publication process. It also means that they need to implement or adapt current requirements, for instance, from funders like PLANES or like the open access mandate of the European Commission and Horizon 2020 and Horizon Europe. But they also must ensure that their platforms are following up-to-date technical web standards. And then we have user expectations, which rely on affordable and reliable services that should not be isolated from their daily research practice, but rather should integrate whenever possible in their research process. And for all and in general, it requires a stable and scalable and reliable market for high quality publications and the distribution of these publications. The following slides, I will compare some limiting factors and suggested solutions from different stakeholder perspectives, and starting with the perspective of authors. And some of these factors and solutions among these stakeholders are different, but they are also some of them which are common. So from the perspective of authors, there is a limiting factor, the lack of perception due to the lack of reputation of the publication initiative. So if I start or I'm running a non-APC publication initiative, one of the first problems is how to make it known to the researchers as potential authors. Then there is often a misunderstanding regarding what open access means and also how the open access publication process can ensure quality assurance processes. And limiting factor, especially for new initiatives, is also that the business model might not be known or not made transparent. But suggested solutions on the other side are to make use of widely recognized initiatives like 2AJ or OA 2020 or S-Course, which are in a position to assess such publication initiatives. With regard to the issues of misunderstanding, of course, there is a need of information campaigns to conduct workshops, to provide fora, and so that the people and initiatives can network and also share their knowledge. And with regard to the transparency issue, of course, the funding and financing flows must be made transparent. From the perspective of the non-APC publishing initiatives, limiting factors can be the lack of an established branding, the limited financial stability, again, the issue if the business model is not transparent, and if the initiative is not yet well established on the market. An idea to solve the problem, some of the problems is to organize cooperatively as a kind of meta publisher or joint venture for smaller publishers. Regarding the business model, an idea is to follow the subscribe to open model. And also to liaise with and cooperate, for instance, with libraries, which hopefully can provide support in terms of staff and infrastructures. And because there are several publication initiatives out there, it's important to highlight the unique selling points of the initiative. Sometimes it can be important to have expert guidance to make the initiative discoverable in search engines. It's important also across these initiatives to communicate best practices and successful business models. But also with regard to the limited resources and limited finances, it's important to share the resources and pooling, for instance, with regard to the infrastructure, but also with regard to a pool of peer reviewers. Now, from the perspective of research institutions, so for instance, for a library, the limiting factor is that even if the open access transformation is ongoing, it can be that the acquisition strategy at the library is still mainly based on the subscription model and not supporting open access publications. Another issue is the central allocation of funds, especially at universities. For libraries, there is not sufficient room to decide to spend the money for different activities. But also there is still often an issue with regard to the research evaluation, which follows, for instance, the journal impact factor and is therefore not quite well suited to evaluate the institution or the researchers. And there can be limited opportunities to support collaborative publishing initiatives. So important here, especially for instance, with regard to the research evaluation, is to develop novel and alternative impact metrics and indicators for research evaluation. And also to consider non-APC publishing as an alternative or new field of activity for research libraries. And last but not least, the perspective of funders and decision makers. The limiting factor, identified limiting factors are concerns regarding the quality of open access publication channels. The issue that many projects which start publication initiatives have only short-term funding. And that there is a high effort required to evaluate publication initiatives due to their huge number, but also due to the variety and diversity of publication channels. There are also, again, a few suggested solutions. As already said, an assessment of initiatives by help of established and trusted initiatives like TOAJ or A2020 is one opportunity, but also again to develop novel and alternative impact metrics for research evaluation and in general to run these publication initiatives by the scholarly community. as a summary and results, we can say that the research funding agencies should recognize and support funding for cooperative non-APC based publication initiatives, and that the problem of short-term versus long-term funding must be solved. Trusted bodies could help to improve the quality control of the publication process, and in general, there must be a strengthening of cooperation, partnership, and community. There's still an open issue of these task activity, and this is to provide best practice guidelines for collaborative and non-APC publishing. This is something that cannot be done only by OpenAIR, but needs to be done by all interested initiatives on a global level. And this was one of the reasons OpenAIR tried to liaise with other initiatives aiming for similar goals. The results are manifested as a deliverable, which was published early this year on Zinodo. So I will have a look at a potential question. There's a question, may I ask if the brokering service is operational or still in development? The broker service is operational. One of the mostly asked questions or frequently asked questions is how can repository managers receive the notifications? This is still an open issue. So one way this works is if the repository manager logs into the provide dashboard, and in the dashboard you can see the notifications of the brokering service. Another opportunity is to receive notifications by email, but there should be also an automated way not to notify the repository manager, but the repository service, and this is still a work in progress, and hopefully will be solved in a few months.
May, can I add something to the broker? The broker was presented in the Provide Community community call in February this year. So you could go to this website for the Provide Community calls and check the day of 5th February. So there are recordings and also slides regarding the broker.
I notice that we are running out of time a little bit.
Oh. So
let's continue with the last part, okay, which Andreas presents.
Cost transparency in open access publishing and the benefits of OpenAIR Research Graph. So as we heard, several ways, there are existing several ways for financing open access publishing today. And we see this shifting the costs to the author sites and institution sites or funders, like with article processing charges or upcoming book processing charges, monography. And here is the point that these shifting should be transparent and so recording. So please click here. And transparency is here an important indicator to estimate also the cost for these open access publishing. In the last years, there are some initiatives created to monitor APCs. And one what I'd like to mention here is, please go back. It's one from UK as a DISC APC monitor. There's another one in Sweden called APC Open APC Sweden. And there's the last initiative that I would like to mention here that are also in our work package is the Open APC that you see here in this slide and small overview about the APCs. But as I said, is not only the APCs are interesting to for transparent recording and reporting, it's also the BPCs. And the Open APC project follows also the transformative agreements. The Open APC project publish their data set on GitHub. And it's open. It's could be couldn't get from GitHub, and you can try some analysis. And we try some analysis with the Open Air Graph. And the Open Air Graph. A short introduction here is the based on the metadata we are collecting via the guidelines, are presenting the graph, inclusive the deduplication and so on. And these information are open also to all via APIs or via dump. The dump is on Zenodo. And we try the first analysis about the coverage between the Open APC data sets that we found on GitHub and the the research graph. And the first analysis we tried in March 2019 and found coverage of 91% around. You see here the distribution of the APC in March that we found in the Open Air research graph. And the most is in around about 2,000 euro here with more than 35,000 articles. We tried this over the year. And in March 2020, we found 98% in from the Open APC dataset in the Open Air graph. And here is the main average APC around also around 2000, and we have more than 40,000 articles there. We do a lot of more analysis, and there we check the average of APCs from the mean APCs from the from a single funder, and we see that it's the first one is a welcome trust. And the European Commission is with around 2,000 euros in the middle field of the average. So in the next slide, we do this same for the March 2020. And we see a shifting. We have more records that we found in Open Air, and in Open Air We have the project and funder relations, and we see that the one of the Wellcome Trust is the first one, and the second is in 2020 the Italian Ministry of Education, University and Research, with a mean APC over 2,000, around about 2,500 euros. Depends on the time. The last slide was to give an overview about the a special project that we picked up in the Open Research Graph with the Open APC dataset. And we see here the time scale from March 2019 to March 2020. And on the left side, the articles. The articles started around 1,300. And in March 2020, we have 2,600 of articles that we found for Horizon 2020. This blue line, the red line is the trend of the average APC. It goes from around 1,800 to 2,400, and growing up is like 30%. And the green line was is the summary of APCs that we see from 3 million to 6 million of million euros that are that we found in the Open APC data set. So this is a small briefly introduction to the analyzing of the APC data sets with the Open Air Research Graph, and that's open to all, and every one can use the data sets on both sides. So that's from my side for the analysis of the APCs here, and we are 6 minutes after three, says. So I don't know if we have time to discuss something. Thank you very much.
At least it was the idea to have time for questions and discussion.
Yeah. You have some time. If there are any questions, of course.
I could put the links from the APC site was in the chat, so you can check the national initiatives and the Open APC initiative.
Andreas, maybe you could add. Are all these links in the presentation?
All links are also in the presentation.
Okay. So in that case, if you send me the presentation, I will add it to the webinar page, so you can people can see it there. Okay. I think this means that you were very clear. So that's good news. If there are any no more questions, maybe we should close.
I mean, one question I still have, and this was about our engagement with other non-APC publication initiatives to work together. And I think we have not yet found a good solution where we can globally discuss this aspect of how can such smaller initiatives be made sustainable? Where can the community share their experiences with business models? I know there are a lot of projects running in the European countries, for instance, but still there. Beside of mailing lists, for instance, I think there is still a lack of such a discussion forum for the community to find out the best, to find out and to discuss best strategies to achieve the vision for cooperative publishing. If any of the participants have suggestions to this regard, you are welcome to share.
Okay. I don't see any raised hands or anything, so I think this means we can close this. For those of you who don't have enough of webinars, in 45 minutes we'll be starting another one in collaboration with Eurodoc. So it's another room, but you can register. If you want to join, you can still register on the open air, open access pages. Oh, so there is one more question from Irina Diktyarova. How the local publishers, so not university ones and not big global actors, can endorse open science in their practices if they are being excluded from scientific communication? You have any opinions on that?
Yes, one approach is we started at least in Germany in the area of book publishers in the social sciences and humanities. Partly connected with Bielefeld University Library and the Transcript publisher. They set up a forum called Enable. And at least this is one way where these smaller book publishers can come together and share their experiences and ideas, but still this is rather a solution on a national level, and the forum itself is also in German, so it doesn't help to discuss if such questions should be discussed more globally. And how they can endorse open science in their practices. I think it's more, it cannot be done by the book publishers alone. Of course, the researchers as authors must be aware of open science principles too. And together, they can follow these open science principles. Yes. One moment. So, go. So it's for libraries, publishers, and authors, with a focus on the social sciences and humanities.
There is another question in the Q&A as well, Jochen. So the question is, if any of the open air guidelines are translate, do they have Arabic language content and metadata?
So for the open air guidelines, institutional and thematic repositories, we have at the moment only a translation to the Spanish language, and also for Portuguese language, and at the moment not yet for Arabic. But if you like to have this, or
I think
participate,
the question is not so much about if the open air guidelines are available in Arabic language, but if the guidelines consider the content in these repositories which is available in Arabic. I would say no, because these guidelines are language agnostic. There's of course some differences between Arabic and Latin languages, but we also need to would have similar challenges with Cyrillic or Japanese, Korean, Chinese languages, and therefore, what we suggest in also in the guidelines, is to follow UTF-8, UTF-8, and coding of information and the metadata.
So the guidelines support mostly language fields like XMLang. So there's some attributes for this. And UTF-8 is for the technical reason in the repository, So the most repository applications support UTF-8, so I don't know UTF-16, but
there's a follow-up question that registration of repositories failed, and here it would be good, if not yet done, if you could create a ticket in the open air help desk system, or you can also write us directly under the following address. Post in the chat. So we get the chat window.
I put the help desk.
Okay, then we hope that that the webinar was helpful and interesting to you. And yeah, it would be nice to stay in contact.
So have a good day and see you.
Thank you very much, Jochen and Andreas. I'm going to close this because we need another room to ready another room for the next webinar. So thank you very much, everybody. The recordings and slides will be made available as soon as possible.